Sushruta Furniture is now available on the Google Play Store. Try it out for free.
Good evening, everybody. I am Professor G.K. Bhatt, taking your biology classes. Hearty welcome to our Jnanadhara classes. In the last few classes, we have dealt with tetrapods with reference to amphibia and reptilia. In today's class, we shall study about birds and mammals. The birds belongs to the class Aves. It belongs to the class Aves. One of the most important characteristics of the birds are the presence of feathers. As you are aware, most of the birds are capable of flying in the air. But there are few birds which cannot fly in the air, and these birds are called flightless birds. The flightless birds, which are mainly seen in New Zealand, New Guinea, are the ostriches, emus, kiwis, cassowaries, etc. In our NCERT syllabus, only mention about ostrich is made. So, most of the birds can fly, except birds like ostriches, rheas, which are found in America, emus, kiwis, etc. The birds are well adapted to fly in the air. Therefore, we say that birds show aerial adaptation. Aerial adaptations. These aerial adaptations are otherwise called volant adaptations. V-O-L-A-N-T, volant adaptations. Birds are known to show aerial or volant adaptations. The birds possess beak. The beak is nothing but modified jaws. Please remember, birds have no teeth. Their beaks are hard enough to cut any hard nut. These are the pictures, figures given in the NCERT book, which shows neoprene. Actually, the figure is different, slightly different. I'll show that later. This is Struthio, scientific name of ostrich. This is Cetacula. Cetacula is commonly called parakeet, or sometimes referred to as a parrot. We don't have in India parrots. What we have are parakeets. The parrots we come across in a circus. So these are the birds: Neoprene, Struthio, Cetacula, Pavo. Let me tell about these birds later when I take them individually. The forelimbs of the birds are modified into wings. What you see actually, these wings, these are the forelimbs. Yeah, they have the hind limbs, no doubt. If the forelimbs are helpful in flying in air, the hind limbs are helpful in walking on land. To walk on the land, they make use of the hind limbs. Look here. These are the pictures of hind limbs. And these hind limbs of the birds like a sparrow, owl, fowl, duck, ostrich, woodpecker, jacana, water bird, these are all modified for their life because they lead life in different habitats. Whatever may be the structure of these hind limbs, all these hind limbs, they generally have scales. We have started hearing about the scales right from the fishes. Fishes do have the scales. Amphibians like Ichthyophis, limbless amphibian, it also has the scales. You know, snakes like reptiles are well known to possess the scales. In birds also you come across the scales. And in mammals also, you are going to see the scales. But whenever we speak about the scales, scales are of two types of origin. What you come across in fishes, we have the scales which are dermal in origin. Therefore, we say the scales are dermal scales. They are of dermal in origin. But the scales that you see in reptiles, the scales you see come across in case of the birds and mammals, the scales here all, they're all of epidermal in origin. Mammals, all, they have epidermal scales. This is the major difference between the scales of fishes and other animals. So, you do observe scales near the hind limb, scales are there. And hind limbs have generally scales and are modified. Hind limbs are modified for walking, as you see in case of the fowl, swimming, as you see in case of the ducks, and also in case of jacana, or clasping tree branches. They clasp the tree branches with their powerful toes. Of course, for which they got adapted. Skin is dry without glands. Very important point. Skin is dry, unlike our skin, where we come across number of different glands. Here, the skin is dry without glands, except one gland. This gland is called oil gland. The oil gland is situated at the base of the tail. You can see here, this is what you have, the tail base. In this base of the tail, we have oil gland. You can see a drop of the oil here, oil gland, and these oil glands are also called uropygial gland. Oil gland is otherwise called uropygial gland, or oil gland is also called preen gland. P-R-E-E-N, preen gland. Preen gland. And this oil is used by these birds to apply on the whole body, both on the outer side and inner side. You can see here, the bird taking the oil from the soil grain and applying it to the inner side also. Now you may ask the question, why that this oil gland is present in birds? What is the significance of oil glands? We do have oil glands by the name sebaceous glands, and that keeps our hairs on the body shining. But for what purpose these oil glands are present in the case of birds? Remember, birds, if you think, the birds are the animals which have to be active throughout the day and they have to remain outside. And now the question that you may think, or I would like to put to you, where these birds go when it rains heavily? Where do they go? Do you think that these birds go to their nest? Answer is no. Most of the birds build their nest only during breeding period. Once these young ones are raised, they abandon the nest. They, no doubt, during breeding period, they construct the nest. Some sort of nest, cup-shaped nest like that. They construct the nest only during breeding period. That too, to raise their young ones. Once they lay the eggs there, and from the eggs, once these young ones hatch out, the moment the young ones hatch out, they don't bother about their nest. We say, most of the birds, they abandon the nest. Abandon the nest the moment the young ones come out of the egg or hatches out. Next, they constructed the nest is in the next breeding period. Of course, some of the birds, they make use of the old nest also. I shall tell about that later. But in general, the birds do not build the nest and live inside the nest throughout the year. Then you may ask, where these birds sleep, sir? Where they take rest? In fact, there are two types of birds, what you say, diurnal birds, which are active during daytime, diurnal birds, and another one is nocturnal birds, which are active during nighttime. So, let me just speak about the birds which are diurnal. Diurnal birds take rest during nighttime. Nocturnal birds sleep during daytime. Okay. During this night sleep, if at all, it may be just like a crow, or you may come across this bulbul bird, or egret bird, or cormorant bird. All these are diurnal birds. And these diurnal birds, at evening time, they go to a particular, their preferred tree. And on the branches of the tree, they make it a point, to just rest on the branches. So, this place where the birds rest during the night time, I am telling about diurnal birds, or during the daytime, I am telling about nocturnal birds. These resting places of the birds are called roosting place. So, the diurnal birds roost on the branches of the tree. Even whenever it is heavily raining, at that time also, they go to one or the other tree. They make it a point to remain in some crevices. If the crevices are not there, they just sit on the branch of tree till the rain subsides. Now you may ask the question, sir, is it not they are going to become wet? Yes, they do become wet. But the thing is that the rainwater never enters in into the body because they have already applied oil to their body surface, both on the external and internal side. As a result of this oil coat on the body, there is no chance that the water enters in. The moment the rain gets subsided, they just shake their body and see that all the water that is just water drops that is remaining, water drops that are remaining on the body just are excluded or removed. So this is the advantage of this oil gland that is present in case of the birds. But at the same time, I have to tell you one more thing, that the birds are provided with movable eyelids. What you see here, of course, they have upper eyelid, lower eyelid. One more transparent eyelid is there. And this transparent eyelid is called third eyelid, or otherwise it's called nictitating membrane. You know, birds, they continuously fly in the air. There are some birds to fly at the speed of 50 miles per hour. Sometimes during migration, some birds fly at the speed of 180 miles per hour. Miles per hour. 180 miles per hour. Now the question is that, when these birds fly with that much of speed and all, is it not that their eye gets hurt? No. Because the moment they start flying, whatever may be the dust particles, etc., are there in the air, they are all prevented from entering into the eye because of this membrane, third eyelid called nictitating membrane. Another important thing is that you may be knowing that there are some birds which continuously fly to the extent of 2 to 3 days without coming down. Without coming down, they fly to the extent of 2 to 3 days. And in fact, you may really wonder if I tell you, say, there are some birds when they are flying continuously for 2 to 3 days, while flying itself, they sleep. They sleep while flying itself. Yet these sleeps are not like our sleep of hours duration, but these sleeps are of a fraction of minutes. Here and there, whenever they fly, whenever that air movement is congenial for them, they simply glide, and at that time they sleep. And this blow of air takes them in the direction wherever they want to go. Like that. So they do sleep whenever they are continuously flying for 2 to 3 days. One more thing that you have to remember is that birds keep always physically fit. They are not like us. They always keep physically fit. The moment they always wake up, you may be knowing that, the birds always wake up during the sunrise. They follow very much dawn and dusk, the sunrise time and also sunset time. I have made a little bit of study on this aspect also. So they exactly keep up the timing. If at all you have a bird nearby your house, and if that bird wakes up at 6 o'clock, and if you just notice that, next day also, they wake up exactly at 6 o'clock, 1 or 2 minutes, that's at this side, depending upon the sunrise. In the same way, they go to bed also at a particular time. We have to learn from birds with regard to punctuality. We have to learn from birds with regard to how to keep the body fit. They do some sort of exercise in the morning. As soon as they wake up, they don't just fly out, fly away. They just make it a point to just jump from a branch to branch and do some sort of exercise and keep their body fit for the whole day activity. And you also know that whenever they fly in the air, they cannot get tired. If they get tired, they'll fall down and it will be the end of their life. At the same time, you might have thought several times, if at all I were a bird, if at all I had wings, if at all I had feathers, if at all I had the opportunity to fly from one place to another place, how nice it would have been. Remember, these birds, even though they have the ability to fly, don't think that it is just like our journey, sitting in the airplane or sitting in this railway or bus and just forgetting everything around us and taking rest. No, birds, when they fly in the air, they have to 100% careful about their enemies, because each and every bird is the prey for another bird, is the food for another bird. These birds, when they start flying, immediately they will be followed by their enemies also, their predator birds also. They have to escape from their enemies and they have to see all around when they are flying. Therefore, if you look into the birds, birds have the capacity to rotate their head by 180 degrees. They can rotate their head by 180 degree. I have already explained to you earlier that in case of reptiles and birds, they have the ability to rotate their head by 180 degree. And these reptiles and birds are known to possess what is called monocondylar skull. Monocondylar skull. With the one occipital condyle and with one occipital condyle, they can rotate their head by 180 degree, which we cannot do. Because amphibians, fishes, and mammals, we have bicondylar skull. So, in this way, the birds are very well adapted to lead aerial life. Endoskeleton is fully ossified. It is a bony ossified. But most important feature is that here, inside of this bone is a hollow. All other animals have the bones, and these bones are filled with the bone marrow. In our case, our longer bones, whatever you do see, they are all filled with bone marrow. But in case of birds, the interior, inner part of the bone is filled with the air, and such bones are called pneumatic bones. Now, why the birds have pneumatic bones? You know, birds have to always fly in the air. To fly in the air, the body should be as light as possible. So, by filling up the air in the longer bone, the body becomes much light. With less expenditure of energy, they can easily fly in the air. The digestive tract of a bird has additional chambers which we do not encounter in other tetrapods in general. And these chambers are the crop and the gizzard. The crop is just to store the food. And you might have seen several times the adult bird, the mother bird, dad or mom bird coming to the nest and feeding their young ones just by regurgitating whatever they have swallowed, bringing back or some sort of vomiting back and putting that food into the maw of the bird. So birds, young birds, baby birds, the birds have additional chambers called crop. Crop is to store the food, and they have gizzard, and gizzard is to grind the food. Right? So, now, heart is completely four-chambered. We have already seen in a crocodile, reptile like a crocodile, we have encountered four-chambered. In case of birds also, heart is four-chambered with two-chambered auricle, two-chambered ventricles. So, thus they are four-chambered just like our mammalian heart. They are warm-blooded animals. Otherwise, they are known as homeothermous animals. They are warm-blooded in a sense. They are able to maintain a constant body temperature. I hope you remember that in animal kingdom, there are two types of animals. One is known as the cold-blooded animal, and another one is known as the warm-blooded animal. So, fishes and amphibians are cold-blooded animals, and cold-blooded animals are also known as poikilotherms. And fishes, amphibians, and reptiles, these three are the examples for poikilotherms, known as animals. Fishes, amphibians, and reptiles, these are the cold-blooded animals, or what we say, poikilotherms. And birds and mammals are warm-blooded animals. What we say, homeothermous animals are the one, whenever there is a change in the external environmental temperature, ambient temperature, their body temperature will not change that much quickly, because we, birds and mammals have the ability to maintain constant body temperature. But this is not the case in case of fishes, amphibians, and reptiles. Whenever there is a change in the external temperature in the environment, the temperature of the fishes, amphibians, and reptiles also change. Suppose you want to measure what is the body temperature of a fish. You need not to take a thermometer and put inside the mouth of the fish. You can just take the temperature of the outer water where the fishes live, and that will be the body temperature of fishes. Another important feature with regard to the birds is that the bird's lungs, you can see the lungs here, the bird lungs are connected to what is called air sacs. Air sacs are connected to the lungs, and these are helpful in supplementing the respiration. If you look at the birds, in general, in birds, there are 9 air sacs. And these 9 air sacs are connected to the lung. And during respiration, it is one of the most important features of the lungs of the birds. During respiration, the lungs are 100% evacuated of the air inside. When we respire, when we exhale, when we give out to the air, our lungs are not 100% empty. Some amount of what we call residual air remains inside our lung. But in case of the birds, when they respire, the lung will be completely sending out this carbon dioxide containing air. Therefore, the respiratory system of the bird is very, very perfect. And you may be knowing that the temperature, body temperature of the birds is also very high, around 35 degrees centigrade. That means there's always high metabolic activities in the birds because it is the need for them, because they are always involved in continuous flying and all. Therefore, the body requires the high input of energy, and which is available because of faster respiratory rate. So, look here. These are the 9 air sacs. 2 are abdominal air sacs. 2 are two are posterior thoracic, 2 are anterior thoracic. These are the abdominal air sacs, 2 posterior thoracic air sacs, 2 anterior thoracic air sacs, 2 plus 2 plus 2, 6. 2 are cervical air sacs, and 1 is interclavicular air sacs. So altogether, bringing the number to 9. Okay, so these, the presence of air sacs makes the lungs to work very perfectly, and it is always responsible for the high amount of energy available to them. Sexes are separate. You can easily make out in some birds which is a male and which is a female. Of course, this is very evident with regard to peacock. This is a peacock. This is a peahen. Peacock is very distinct, beautifully colored, and I am sure that every one of us are very much attracted by the tail feathers it has. So, this is peahen. So, in most of the birds, the sexes are separate, and they are easily distinguishable. Now, if at all you come across any one pair of birds, and if at all you want to identify which is the male bird, which is the female bird, it is quite easy. You can recognize the male bird by one of the important features. In most of the birds, males are very handsome. Brightly colored bird. When you come across two birds with one near each other, the most beautiful colored birds are the males. The sober colored, little bit of dull colored bird is the female. Of course, it is not for all the birds. If at all you ask me, sir, in the crow, which is the male and which is the female, it is difficult to tell. There is no such a color differentiation. It is difficult. In all birds, it is not that there is a distinct sexual dimorphism. But There are few birds where there is a distinct sexual dimorphism. The male birds are beautifully colored when compared to the female bird. Fertilization is internal, but there are no any penis-like structure which you come across in reptiles. Reptiles are hemipenises are there. We do not come across any such penis. You can see here, this is the male bird and this is the female bird. What happens during mating is that the male bird presses its cloacal aperture onto the cloacal aperture of the female, and this semen is just passed into the body of the female. So during this mating, the male presses the cloaca onto the cloaca of the female. But remember, prior to that, there is one elaborate process, quite interesting process, about which you have heard in the last class, that is courtship behavior. Courtship behavior. Each of these birds, prior to getting its partner, they do show courtship behavior. In one or the other way, they just indicate their wish to get into the courtship behavior to the female, and female, only when it agrees, it approaches the male and gives her consent to the mating. Without any consent of the male cannot mate in case of the birds. Okay? So, they are oviparous, always laying the eggs. You can see that these eggs and all. And development is direct. There is no larval stage. Now, these are some of the examples. We shall look one by one. This is a Corvus crow, right? My pet bird. I like this crow very much. Most of you don't like, I think. Why? Why that I like this crow very much? Just let me tell you, the crow is the nature's scavenger. Whatever that gets killed at night time, whatever that falls on the road, I have made some study in Kudremukha National Park area. So, in this, I have seen that these crows, they very systematically remove these dead bodies, carcasses from the road by eating on them. Even in these towns, you might not have seen this, you might not be seeing this crow during daytime. Good number of crows, they wake up much early. And as soon as they see one or the other carcasses on the road, immediately they feed on that. The moment you wake up, prior to that, you see that these dead bodies are totally removed. So, in this way, the crow is nature's scavenger. Apart from this, the crow also has the forethought for tomorrow. This crow, always, if at all it gets more food, which is not required by it, it stores that food for the next day and makes it a point to eat that food that is left out on the previous day. I have made this study, and let me tell that in another time. So, in this way, crows are always bothered about tomorrow. They don't waste the food, whatever they get to today. They keep that food safely for the next day, and next day they make use of that food, whatever that was left on the previous day. Is it not that we have to love these crows? We have to learn certain lessons from this crow also. So, this is the Columba pigeon, dove it is commonly called, and this is what you have. You can see there, the birds are studied by putting some rings, what we call bird ringing. And on these rings, some codes are used. And by the study of these, you can see, you can know which bird has come from which state, which country. And every postmaster general of the country will be having a register. In that register, all the information will be written. So if at all you come across any bird with such a ring, and you notice that, if at all you are the one who is studying this bird migration, what you have to do, you have to catch that bird. Of course, there are many different methods. Some BNHS Bombay that gives some training. You have to just remove that existing band. Of course, they are the very light bands, and just have it. And you just leave another band of your own with a coded message and leave it, it will fly away. And this coded message, what are that coded message? You can get the all information when you refer that information with, or when you just share that information with the Postmaster General of every country. So, in this way, bird migrations are studied. No time for us to elaborate on that. Now, this is what the Sitacula, that is a parakeet. We don't have parrot in India. What we do have in India are the parakeets. Parrots are beautifully multicolored. And these are one or two colored ones. And these are the parakeets. And parrots we come across in foreign countries like America, England, etc. So now, this is the picture of the ostrich. And ostriches, you know, they cannot fly, but they can run fast. And in the deserted area, these are used just to cover or to have the ride. And ostrich ride is one of the most famous type of attraction in some of these deserted areas. And these ostriches are capable of eating the stones, pebbles, grass pieces, bolts, nuts, etc. And that comes out through their fecal matter next day. This is the peacock pavo, our national bird. And these are the Echinodites or penguins found in the Arctic and Antarctic area. And this is the neopron, vulture, right? Now, this already have told you about that. And this is what simply called sunbird. Sunbird. Okay. Let me just brief a little about the sunbird. See that how much beautifully curved beak it has, how much beautiful colored body it has. And I did some research work. I did a study, some sort of nesting behavior of this bird. You can see here. This is utility area of my house at Manipal. I have my own house at Manipal, which I have given for the rent now. I am staying at Bangalore now. So here, when I was staying there in the utility area, I have noticed that bird coming there and trying to build some nest like this. In somewhat in the year 2003 or 4, the bird has built a nest like this. It laid the eggs like that. And we are very happy that the bird has trusted us. It has taken me as if I am their, or me and wife, we are their good friends. But at that time, in 2003, like that, I have not closed this open area of the utility, and it was all open. All this was open. Easily, any bird can come in and go out. Any cat also can come and go out like that. And it has built the nest like that. And it had laid the eggs like that. And one day, because of some other program, we had gone out. We are not there at night and that day. On that day, when we are not there, some bats have entered at night. Bats. And bats have spoiled everything there. And when the next day when we came, there was nothing. We felt very bad. In the very next year, again, that bird, that I don't know whether it's the same bird or some different bird, they came there. Both the mother and the father, dad and mom, both started building the nest like that. At that time, we thought that this time we should give 100% protection to that and it should go with the kids. So, immediately me and my wife, we planned something and we started bringing some gunny bag like that, and we used some bed sheets and such like that, and we just stitched and completely covered it and left some holes by putting some bangles there, and about four holes we made here and there, and just to allow them to come inside and go outside. And these birds, mother and dad, they are seeing what all you are doing. We did not do it in a single day. We just started putting these little, so that they sort of come and go like that, and they got habituated just to enter there and to go. And finally, we completed this side also. Quite a interesting result we got. What happened? And this made these birds to successfully lay the eggs and to raise the young one. You can see that. Of course, in these sunbirds, you can easily make out the beautifully colored, which I had shown in my previous slide. It was a father. And this is mother. You can see that mother is feeding this particular baby bird inside the nest. Okay? Then, after a few days, see, this is the dad bird feeding that. Both dad and mom used to take care of that. This is really good interest work. And one has to stay there throughout with the camera. And you can count how many times the dad feeds, how many times the mom feeds, how many times they eat and all. It is quite interesting. I don't have sufficient time to elaborate on that. It will be another day's talk. So, in this way, now, after a few days, the young ones, this is a mom, the young ones came out. See here, this young one, it has come out now. And it is just waiting to run away, to fly away from our house. So, this is a young one now, so beautiful now. And finally, they just went out. So, that's all about these birds. I hope it is quite interesting. Yes, do you have any questions on birds? I'll be happy. Nikki? Okay. If there are no questions, we shall move on to class Mammalia, our own class, to which we belong. Mammals are found in a variety of habitats, wherever life is possible. In all that places, we encounter the mammals. In polar ice caps, deserts, mountains, forests, grasslands, dark caves, everywhere, we encounter mammals. And even some of them have adapted to fly in the air, you know, bats. And some of them are adapted to live in water, as you know, dolphins, whales, porpoises, seals, etc. This is the bat, adapted to fly in the air. Whale, adapted to swim in the water with the flippers. Again, whales. The most unique mammalian characteristic is the presence of milk-producing glands called mammary glands. Therefore, the name mammals, because of the mammals, by which the young ones are nourished. Mammals have two pairs of limbs, four limbs and hands, adapted for walking, running, climbing, burrowing, swimming, or flying. For all these, the limbs are well adapted. Now let us see them. This is what you have, the limbs for walking, right? For running, we say cursorial adaptation for faster running. For climbing the trees, arboreal adaptation. For burrowing in a sand, fossorial adaptation. And this is what you have, the figures in your NCERT book, Ornithorhynchus, commonly called duck-billed platypus. Macropus, commonly called kangaroo. Pteropus, commonly called bat. And Balaenoptera, commonly called whale. Right? Please remember these pictures. The skin of mammals is unique in possessing hair. Look into our ancestors. How much hairs are there on the body? Unique in possessing the hairs. And also they are unique in possessing so many glands in the body, like the sebaceous glands which produce this oil, or sweaty gland which produces the sweat. The external ears or pinnae are present. The exposed part of the ear is called external ear or pinna. Different types of teeth are present, you know. We use the term heterodont. There are different types of teeth, like incisor for cutting, canines for tearing the flesh, premolars and molars for grinding. Heart is four chambered with two auricles and two ventricles. Mammals, just like birds, are homeothermous. Respiration is by lungs. One thing you have to remember, whether a mammal is aerial like bat, or terrestrial like we people, or aquatic like that of the whales, dolphins, etc., all the mammals have lungs as the respiratory organ. Even though there are aquatic mammals, lungs are the respiratory organ. You must know the aquatic animals are of two types. Primary aquatic animals and secondary aquatic animals. Secondary aquatic animals. That means fishes are primary aquatic animals because they have originated and evolved in water only. Those which are primary aquatic animals, they have gills as the respiratory organ. Gills as the respiratory organ. In case of secondary aquatic animals. What is secondary aquatic animals? Secondary aquatic animals are the one which have evolved on the land, originated on the land, evolved on the land, and they have taken aquatic life secondarily. They have gone to the water secondarily. They have evolved mainly on the land. Now, if you look into turtles, amongst reptiles, or tortoises, and also if you look into that of the crocodiles, and whales, dolphins, like that, all these mammals, all these are secondary aquatic animals. And you may really wonder if it will say, even if you come across whales today in ocean, whales evolved on land. Whales were living on the land and then they got into water. And those which have evolved secondarily, or those which are secondary aquatic animals, those which evolved on the land and then came to the water, all these secondary aquatic animals possess lungs as the respiratory organ. Lungs as the respiratory organ. So, respiration is by lungs, whether they are aquatic, whether they are terrestrial, or whether they are aerial. In all, we have lungs as the respiratory organ. Sexes are separate. You can make out the male and female. Fertilization is internal. Read this. Wife is a wife, no matter who the hell you are. The wife shouting at the husband, as your dad does in front of your mother, when she is shouting at you, at your father, what dad does? Like this, keeps quiet. This is not different, even with regard to the wild animals. Okay, just a fun, okay, right. They are oviparous, giving birth to young one, with few exceptions, and development is a direct, no larval stage. Echidna, example, oviparous. We have few of the mammals which are known to lay the eggs, and we call them egg-laying mammals. This is the one. It is called spiny anteater. Common name is spiny anteater. It eats ants. Spiny anteater. Echidna. oviparous, egg-laying mammal. We have another one also. I shall show you beautiful pictures. This is duck-billed platypus. You know, it is called Ornithorhynchus. This is also another example for egg-laying mammals. Most of the mammals, they give birth to young ones. There are few mammals which lay the eggs, and they are called egg-laying mammals. Egg-laying mammals, they are the connecting links between reptiles and mammals. These are young ones, cute ones, young ones of duck-billed platypus. See, the bill, it is just like a duck-billed platypus. Now, these are all some examples. We shall go through these examples one by one. Okay, now, the Ornithorhynchus, commonly called platypus, is the oviparous mammal, egg-laying mammal, just like that of the echidna. Yes, Ornithorhynchus platypus, duck-billed platypus, aquatic one it is, come to the land also. Macropus, kangaroo, see the brood pouch it has. In this pouch, it shelters the young one, and it hops on the land with the long hind limbs, jumps, hops on the land, very common in Australia. And this is the pteropus, flying fox, commonly called flying fox, or it is a fruit bat. Always, whenever it takes a rest, it hangs down. It can hang down from our roof of the houses also, hangs down. And one of the most important feature of this, even it has eyes. The eyes are of no use at the time of locomotion, and it always depends on what is called echolocation. Echolocation. It produces the sound, and that sound gets reflected, and by that, after striking some object, it gets reflected. By that, it will start finding its way. Okay. Sorry. Finds its way. So, camelus, camel. This is a macaca, monkey. So cute. Rattus, rat. Canis, dog. Felis, cat. Elephas, elephant. We have two types of elephants. Whatever we have in Africa, they are different from what we have in India and Asia. We accordingly call Asian elephant and African elephant. This is the Asian elephant, Elephas maximus. The difference is that this is African elephant. African elephant has very big ears, and it belongs to Loxodonta. And in African elephant, even the female possesses a tusk. In Asian elephant, only male possesses a tusk, female does not. Equus, it is a horse. And this is the delphinus, common dolphin. This you are supposed to remember. This is aquatic dolphin, river dolphin. Sorry, river dolphin, not aquatic. All dolphins are aquatic. It is a Ganges river dolphin, seen in a Ganga river like that. And this is a national aquatic animal of India. You have to remember very much. And it is called Platanista gangetica, seen in a Ganges river. Therefore, it is called Ganges river dolphin, national aquatic animal of our country. Balaenoptera, blue whale. Again, blue whale. And this is a panthera, tiger is a tiger. And this is a lion, panthera, leo. And these are some of the orders which you are supposed to know and remember. Because in just 3 years back, in one of these NEET examination, it was asked, horse belongs to the order. Horse belongs to the order. Perissodactyla. Perissodactyla. And this cow deer belongs to the order Archaeodactyla. So like that, any of these orders may be asked, you must know about these orders to be on the safer side. And this is what you have, a table in this Animal Kingdom chapter 18, be thorough. This table summarizes whatever you have studied with regard to different phyla, and please be thorough with that. And with this, our Animal Kingdom chapter gets over. So we shall meet with another chapter in the next class. Now, I'll be pleased to answer the question if you have any doubts. Please. Yes, it appears so, no doubt. So let me conclude today's class. I shall meet you with the next new chapter in the next class. Thank you. Bye. Bye.
Welcome to Sushruta app. In this video we are going to demo NEET topics and its related resources from slides and videos. Kindly give all the necessary permission and proceed to the main screen. Let us select Biology 11th as our subject. This will open up the syllabus for this subject. All the syllabus data regarding the subject will be loaded at this stage. Once the process is complete, the icon will be active. Zoom a bit so that the topics are clearly visible and click on the orange highlighter button. This will open up a selection box. Adjust the box so that it covers the topic you are interested in. Once this is done, confirm your selection by clicking on the green button. This will download the slides resources for that unit. Once the download is complete, it will ask you for the permission to download the textbooks from the NCERT site. Once the download is complete, it will open up the chapter and the subchapter hierarchy for the unit. Select one of the subchapter. In this case, I am selecting the first subchapter. It will load all the resources pertaining to that topic. Let us click the second icon, that is textbook. You will be given an option if there are many resources. Now you can see, it has directly taken us to the page of the selected topic. Click on the small green button to load all the icons back. Similarly, let us select the third icon, that is slides. It will open up the slides for the said topic. Finally, let us select the third icon, that is YouTube videos. This will show the videos related to the topic from IITPAL. If there are more than one video, select any one of the links and watch the video. Similarly, let us select another topic and follow the same procedure. Remember, downloading of slides is a one-time process per unit. Slides are being downloaded here, as we have visited this unit for the first time. The next time we visit the same unit, slides will be retrieved locally. We can also select a topic from slides and get its equivalent matching resource. In this case, I am selecting the topic, taxonomic categories, and getting its equivalent topic from the textbook. So here we have the textbook resource showing taxonomic categories. When there are too many topics selected, or the topic name match is not found, the list of entire topics will be shown to the student. He can select any one topic and proceed further. Let's click on the Moodle icon, seen on the syllabus screen. This will take you to the Moodle calendar, where you will be able to view all the scheduled events. Let us click on one of the events. There is an event for Biology Unit 1. On clicking it, we'll give a live lecture Google Meet link in it. Clicking on the link will directly open up Google Meet app where the lecture will be taken. Let us select a topic from the biology syllabus and proceed further. Now let us click the first icon that is Gyan Chat. Gyan Chat is a medium where the students can interact with the other students via channels. Each subject unit will be having its own dedicated channel. Students can share their doubts or thoughts via this channel. Gyan Moodle would directly take you to the course material for that particular unit. These course materials will be uploaded on Moodle by the lectures. Now let us try out a different subject, that is physics. Let us click the textbook icon, and select the second option. This will open up a message box, displaying the page number, of the Kindle version of HC Verma book. On clicking OK it will open up the Kindle app with the book loaded. Once the book is loaded, click on the hamburger icon on the top, and select the Go To option. This opens up a dialog box, asking you to enter the page number. Enter the same page number, which was shown to you earlier, and click OK. This will directly take you to the page related to the topic you selected. Now let us see the formula sheet for physics. Formula sheet is provided to get a quick reference of all the formulas covered in the syllabus. If you want to refer to a topic from the formula sheet, simply select the topic and proceed further. We are also providing a link to the CEngage app. On clicking the CEngage icon, it will open the CEngage app. You will find all the test material inside My Bookshelf option. Finally, you can take the mock tests using the National Test Appeals app. Clicking on the icon will take you directly to the National Test Appeals app, where you can try out mock tests. Whenever a QR code is found inside the textbook, the student can select the QR code and he will be provided with e-content material. In this particular case, we have contents related to text PDF. In some cases, there will be video content, graphic and interactive content. Let us see how video content would look like from a different chapter.
Hello, my dear students. Very glad to meet you all. I am Professor G.K. Bhatt. In 2018 or during 2018 to 2020, I got an opportunity to visit nearly 25 institutions. And I used to teach in all these institutions biology, preparing the students for NEET exam. For NEET exam, you must be thorough with each and every word given in the NCERT book. That means biology, you have to buy out the NCERT book. Not simply by hitting, understanding the concept and by hitting. That is what is expected. Now let us start with this particular chapter, that is Animal Kingdom. And we shall look into the various components that is given here in the Animal Kingdom chapter. Under basis of classification. What we are looking, what characters, what points we are looking to classify the animals. That is what we are studying under basis of classification. In spite of differences in structure and form of different animals, there are a lot of difference in the structure, in their form, gross morphology. There are certain fundamental features common to various individuals. There are certain features common to various individuals in relation to arrangement of cells, body symmetry, nature of coelom, patterns of digestive system, circulatory system, or respiratory.
We also have live lectures by world-class and dedicated tutors.
Well, that's all for this demo. Thanks for watching.